Feeling stuck inside, needing to rock. Feed your soul at the air drum party.
You know you're an air drummer. Come out of the closet. I did.
I find myself sitting there and air drumming along with all my favorite records.
Totally relates to the air drumming thing. I would make these wonderful drum sets out of magazines and then beat the covers up.
Right now, Adventures of Power, the cult movie about air drumming, is teaming up to raise money for musicians in need and to rock your pants off.
Music is not about having arms. Music is about having spirit.
With a free online watch party where you can chat with the cast, comedians, and celebrity drummers. Who knows who might stop by? Save the world. Feel the rock. Be the power. Come to airdrummer.com.
We want to see you.
Rock.
You can do it.
Do it. Do it. Come on. Do it now.
So, hi. Hi, guys.
What's up?
What's up?
We are starting to be live. Modern Drummer's feed is about to go live. My name is ARI GOLD. I'm the director of Adventures of Power and the host of the Air Drummer Drums Experience presented by Modern Drummer magazine. I am here with Matt Ochoa and Carlos Verdugo, who have played together. They have brought the Southern California ska, reggae, rock experience to the masses.
Single-handedly.
Single-handedly, but double bass drummedly.
Yes, yes.
Well, actually, no, Carlos is a single bass drum. He's not doing a...
Currently single bass drum.
Yeah.
Seeking
other bass project. Drum.
Under the level of Terry Bozzio with his... bass drums, one for each note in the scale. So we're talking about drums. We're talking about my movie, Adventures of Power. I'm in the Guinness Book of Records for air drumming.
That's amazing.
Some of you
I didn't know you could do that.
I didn't know I could do that either.
That's pretty impressive.
That happened. I would love to hear a little bit about. Well, first of all, I noticed that you guys both cite Stuart Copeland as influences drummers. Is he like for you guys the foundation of like the merging of rock and pop and reggae and ska?
I would say so. I mean,
have you ever air drummed to Stuart Copeland?
Oh yeah, many a time.
Oh yeah,
yeah. And I never get the parts right though. I'm always off. Like I think I know what he's gonna do, but then he changes it up.
Yeah.
Yeah, Stuart Copeland, amazing drummer.
He, what's interesting, you know, Neil Peart is in my movie and they seem like such different drummers, but there was a great mutual respect and friendship between those two guys. And you can actually hear some Stuart Copeland influence and some Rush stuff from the early 80s.
Did you ever get to meet Stuart Copeland?
I haven't met him yet, but I did send him a air drum video last week that I filmed on Mount Whitney in the snow. And he liked it on Twitter.
Yes.
Start.
Yes.
Start. I know the guys at Modern Drummer know him too. So, you know, maybe one of them will I'm getting some hearts on Modern Drummer, which is nice. I'd love to know, Carlos, once you because you're in the top of my screen and you actually have a real drum set, which is, makes me a little insecure as an air drummer, but I'd love to know how you got into rock and into playing, but also like, did you start thinking about like, you know, reggae ska type beats, or you know, what was your first influence?
I mean, my first upbringing was a lot of punk rock, you know. So my first band was punk, and I kind of.
Well, what is punk to you? Because punk means different things to different people.
Well, I mean. When I was growing up, I mean, I'm kind of a little bit later generation, but you know, I like a lot of Suicidal Tendencies.
We had Rod Diaz last week on the show.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. I mean, just, you know, all kinds of different bands, you know, Face to Face was a kind of newer punk rock band that I liked. I liked a lot of, the Descendants, you know, with Bill Stevenson.
Yeah. Okay.
He's one of my favorite drummers.
Yeah, I had a girlfriend who was really into Descendants, and I was a little confused because I felt like drums should be louder. but I never saw them live. So she was playing like the way it's mixed, it doesn't sound as like intense and aggressive as like metal drumming or like suicidal tendencies, the way they mixed her drums, like where it was like you feel like if you're standing next to the drummer, you might get killed. Whereas the tendency had a more gentle approach, you know.
Well, Suicidal Tendencies had Brooks Wackerman playing for him for a while on Freedom, that album, and that drumming is super technical.
Yeah. Okay. So you got in through punk, and speed was your thing, but then you know, playing with
not speed, but like, you know, speed like fast.
Yes. Well, you know, I meant speed.
Like, you never know. I mean, that's
the original
meaning.
The original meaning of speed.
I mean, it is COVID age right now, so I mean, you never know. People are going doing crazy stuff.
Yeah. Well, so but Sublime with Realm is not a either speed or speed the drug.
Yeah.
You know, that's not the foundation of the feel.
Yeah, reggae is the feel, you know, but there's a lot of punk rock influence, you know, which does have a lot of fast drumming, you know.
Right.
But I feel like Stuart Copeland was kind of my bridge into reggae, you know, because he had so many really cool reggae licks and different diverse ways of playing the drums that you wouldn't hear as a normal something on the radio that you'd be listening to, you know.
I mean, he was listening to Lebanese music as a child. So there's a lot of influence of North Africa in his sound as well, which I don't think the other guys in the band really had that. But, you know, that's one of the things that gave it such a weird sound, I think.
He's very worldly, I would say.
Yeah, I think his dad was in the CIA. If I have that correctly.
That explains a lot.
Yeah. So, and Matt, like, so I'd love to hear a little about your background. What got you into drumming? What inspired you?
Yeah, I started basically in middle school, like a concert band. You know, it was just one of the classes that I had.
Is that mean you're playing classical music or?
Well, like, I mean, you know, there.
It's a grand old flag.
It was like okay, what would you like to play? You have flute and trumpet and trombone, and then there's the percussion section. And I saw the drums and I was like, I mean, anything to make loud noise. So basically gravitated towards that. And
did you start on like a single like triangle or something like that and work?
Basically you have to take a test. As long as you can go right, left, and basically just, you know, stay on the beat, then you passed and you were able to do it. So that was extremely difficult for me, but I eventually passed. And growing up, it was just, yeah, paradiddles was like, that was the hard part. That was like, you know, level 6 or something like that.
By the way, I'm going to turn Modern Drummer on the side and just say who we are. And for those, you guys, talk to me in 1 second. What are your Instagram accounts so I can give it to the Modern Drummer people?
Yeah, at Maddie DH.
Uh-huh.
And mine is at CLOS Drums, CLOS. DRUMS.
CLOS drums?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Pin. Okay, there we go.
Boom.
He's better now. Oh, and I should say Sublime with Rome and Birdie Heads. Okay. Whatever. This is high tech. We're living in land. We're streaming to the people. This is a live show, and it's like the microphone's broken. We're still rocking. So, I'd love to hear a little bit about how Dirty Heads and Sublime with Rome kind of are cousin bands, how they work together, how they inspire each other. You guys have played on stage together as part of these bands, but as part of other touring bands. Like, what's it like? Is there a rivalry between you?
No, it's more like it's like a brotherhood. Actually, is a. When Dirty Heads, I'd say 2010, maybe 2008, 2010, we were going to a studio in Costa Mesa, and there was this kid Rome that was kind of just going to the studio and writing his own music and whatnot, and we kind of just met Rome at the studio, and cool kid, wrote awesome songs and started collaborating with him. He started writing with our guys. I started doing some sessions for his solo stuff. And that's kind of just how we became like friends and just to kind of know each other and all that kind of stuff. And then Sublime with Rome formed and we have the same management. So it's all kind of been like in the same family, as far as Rome and Dirty Heads. And yeah, so that's been 12 years now, probably 12 years now. And we've since then we've had like tours together. And
Before that, actually, I used to play in a band called Tribal Seeds, and we played with Dirty Heads a bunch of times. And we actually did a tour with Tribal Seeds, Sublime with Rome, and Dirty Heads. And that's pretty much how
you were in Tribal Seeds at that time, right?
Yeah, I was in Tribal Seeds at that time, and so that's how I got to know all the guys. And then kind of the next tour that we went on, or that I went on with Sublime with Rome, is like. Felt like my second tour because we hung out a bunch and it was all good times.
That's right.
Now, do you ever go back to like first wave ska in terms of, you know, studying influences? Like I happen to be like a huge fan of like Justin Hines and you know, early Toots and the Maytals and this kind of stuff. Like is that stuff like too ancient history and the drums too crunched to even know what to do with it in terms of influence? Because the recordings back then, you know, they'd have like one microphone in the room of, you know, the back of a record shop, but you know, and the drums and the piano would sort of become one instrument from the recording. But do you guys ever listen to that stuff? Or
yeah, I feel like that's the evolution in music. You know, everything changes down the line and things have to get more technical for some reason, but those are magical recordings, you know,
something for me in the lack of fidelity that I really like in those early first wave ska recordings. And actually we're working on doing a show with some like second wave ska, like Specials and Untouchables and people like that.
Awesome.
And I love that the influence to that island has sort of has spread out in such a beautiful way into different sounds that it's infused, you know, Dirty Heads obviously is not exclusively in that genre, but like it's still, the lineage is still in the music and in the feeling of like sunniness.
Yeah.
Which for me is like a lifesaver when I listen to music with Jamaican influence to cheer me up, and people are like, oh, you're happy all the time. I was like, no, I'm happy all the time because I listen to this. Otherwise I would be screwed. You're
like, no, it definitely
puts you in a mood.
No,
yeah.
Yeah. So by a message. Oh, by the way, Archie, do you guys know Archie's ice cream? I'm not sure if you personally or someone on your team, but I want to give a big shout out to Archie's ice cream. A guy named Shant who has this rock and roll ice cream truck that you can rent for your events. And he's how we ended up meeting. So,
nice.
So thank awesome. You, Shant. And
thank
anyone,
you.
Especially in the Orange County area or LA area, if you want to rock, his ice cream trucks are signed by all the biggest rock stars in the world. So you guys belong in there.
Nice. But
we got to get you over there.
Yeah, I'll get in there. And well, I'll sign your personal, I'm going to get inside your drum set back there because as an air drummer, I have, you know, insecurity issues when I see a guy named like Carlos with an actual drum set.
Oh, come on.
This is a green screen back here, actually.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
It's one of those background filters for Zoom.
Yeah.
Yes, I get, because I'm in the Guinness book for air drumming, I do get a lot of questions. Do I play drums? And I have played drums, but I am definitely a better air drummer. I am a drummer.
Nice.
And so Matt, you were able to watch Adventures of Power?
Yes.
Tell me, did you have any moments of touching yourself watching my movie?
The entire time.
Okay. What part of the movie made
it was
you
like this? The most? My face was melting from all face. The acid.
Yeah. No, I was said jokingly that we're a drug-free zone here at airdrummer.com, but that my movie is good on acid, but that was a joke. It was a joke.
I'm going back now. I'm going back for a second round. After this. So
what are you guys doing to keep yourself sane during lockdown? I see Matt is learning how to play stringed instruments because as a drummer, he thinks he can also do melody.
I mean, I kind of have just been using this time. Like, I've been playing drums all the time. I have a Roland kit in the garage. Shout out to Roland. Thank you. Awesome. But not only that, like, I've been using the time to, like, pick up another instrument or take an online course of mixing or just doing home projects or, you know, learning how to build a bench that comes out very...
Are you doing carpentry? Are you really doing carpentry?
I'm attempting to do... I bought a circular saw.
By the way, there's a lot of I love yous and hearts in the comments, which to me indicates... the possibility of bro love. But if it's not bro love, then there may be female love, which maybe, and then I'm just reading into this, but maybe they're thinking of you shirtless in the shed, like doing your carpentry.
Oh, with my circular saws.
Your body glistening as the sawdust flies all over you.
Building birdhouses for the whole neighborhood.
Wondering if maybe that's a thing.
Starting making drumsticks.
Hey, drums. Are you making drumsticks?
No. Okay. I'll leave that to the professionals.
Yeah.
But I do, speaking of drumsticks, I wanted to show you guys this. This is an amazing Christmas present that I got from my lovely Aunt Kim.
Ooh.
Sick.
Glow in the dark. Delight.
I think even though as an air drummer, I don't use real sticks, I might make an exception. No, for those I could make.
I know, these are against the rules in air drumming, aren't they?
Vader, baby.
Well, I
don't know what brand these are.
You know, there's a thing in Adventures of Power that even having a stool is cheating, or it's not cheating, but you know, you separate the men from the mice when you air drum with no stool, because being in that squat position for a long period of time, and I did a Hot for Teacher in Finland in front of 7,000 people, and doing that opening with the double bass drum and the tom
while you're standing in a squat position
while in squat position, and I had made an edit of the song at 60 seconds, literally just 60 seconds, and I did those 60 seconds, rocked it, I will say.
There you go.
Airdrummer.com if you want. And then I was hyperventilating for like 4 hours afterwards. Level of exhaustion from 60 seconds.
That's got to be a workout. That's an intense workout.
Like, I'm telling you guys, like, if you want to get in shape, forget the drums.
We're doing it wrong, Carlos.
Yes, yes. Get in a squat position.
My bad.
Do a hopper teacher.
I applaud you, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, it's earned me, well, some free plane tickets around the world.
Great. I will say this.
About that.
I don't want to spoil it for anybody. I mean, I don't think it's spoiling it for anybody in the movie, but I am very impressed with how accurate the air drumming is to all the songs that I heard in that movie. Well,
when you do an air drum movie, you can't.
You gotta be on it.
Okay, so like there's an air tabla player in the movie, and so for that I was like, I tried to cast a bunch of Indian actors who were not drummers, and they'd come in and they'd have a good look and a good accent, and and then they would do this.
And you're like,
in your hand, and it was terrible. Yeah. And so I was like, okay, so for this part, I need somebody who actually each finger looks like in the correct place for playing tablas.
Yeah.
So I ended up casting a dental student who played tablas. And by putting up signs around LA, I found a guy who was a real tabla player, also a dentist. And he ended up doing the part of the Indian guy who he's the king of the until he gets, well, for those who see the movie, he gets disqualified. He gets disqualified for playing hand drums because there's a kind of like a air drum racism theme in the movie.
Was there a lot of editing that had to go down to like actually match those parts to be?
Well, I mean, me and everyone else who was in the movie learned the songs really accurately so that we could, you know, have the shots go as long as possible with accuracy. But
I'm just trying to get, are you a one take kind of guy, or like, Is it like third
take? Are you punching in on the air drumming?
That's a good question. As a musician, I know you understand this. No, but yeah, I mean, some of my like I did YYZ. When I've done it live, it's a one take thing. On screen, you know, we would cut for the best take. But like, yeah, I did. I mean, I've done Rush. I've air drummed Rush in front of Rush.
You're probably nervous about that.
You can't mess around.
No.
I mean, I air drummed Tom Sawyer while Neil Peart was playing Tom Sawyer on drums in the same room.
That's so pretty awesome.
I'm a one take wonder. Okay, here's the question. Matt, how were the Corona concerts with fans in the car?
They were awesome because it let us actually have concerts. They were, you know, not like a normal concert, to say the least. It was so we did some on the West Coast and we did some on the East Coast. The thing about the East Coast is that I feel like there's a lot more room and less restrictions as far as noise and sound ordinances or whatever. So I definitely enjoyed the East Coast ones because I just felt like people were closer. Like it was closer to a normal show than it was here on the West Coast. But they were awesome. You know, it was like with what's going on, I didn't, you know, who knows when shows are coming back, and to be able to do a drive-in or like, you know, come up with something like that, you know, like a drive-in concert. It was pretty awesome. So I enjoyed them. Carlos, you did some too.
Yeah. What'd you do?
Yeah. We did some drive-in shows. We actually played this really crazy like biker rally in the Ozarks. And that was not a social
cool.
distance show.
Oh my God. I have to, I really want to see this. Paint some images. I want to.
I'm already like imagining what's happening.
Well, I heard it was bigger than Sturgis.
Huh?
It was bigger than Sturgis. The biker rally was.
I don't know what Sturgis is. I mean, am I a stupid person?
Sturgis.
Google it.
Okay.
Google it one day. Yeah. But Sturgis is like,
when I don't have multiple hands on multiple devices right now.
It's a huge biker rally.
Okay. Okay. So it's bigger than Sturgis. How did you, so is this with Sublime with Rome?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my God. What was it like?
We played out there. It was just chaos, man. That was the last actual show we played that I was blown away that it, number one, happened, and number two, it was just like, we didn't know going into it that it was going to be like that. You know, we just thought it was going to be a social kind of distant show, and got there and it's just madness.
Like mud. Was it, I'm picturing mud and like guys like doing,
you know, burnouts,
donuts.
Yeah.
And maybe a little bit of fist fighting in the front row. Like and maybe bro hugs afterwards from the, like, uncomfortably close bro hugs with the audience afterwards.
Yeah. I got a really cool shirt. This one biker was walking around the whole day, and I saw him, and his shirt said, F COVID, let's ride. And so at the end of the night, I was like, oh, that's a cool shirt, you know? And he's like, oh, here, he took it off his back, and he's like, what, here, nice, you can have it. And I'm like, oh,
it should be.
Thanks, you know? So I took it and I put it in a trash bag and I tied it up, and
you steamed
I got
it,
home, you know, and put a bunch of bleach on it and stuff. And so it's my dog's now, but cool story.
Wait, it's your dog now? Cause
it's my dog's. Yeah.
Is that a compliment to the shirt? I hope.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Cause your dog has a good style.
Oh, he's got great style.
I hear he has more Instagram followers than you do.
I think he does.
Okay. I just love bikers at a reggae concert. That's amazing.
Question Sublime show? Yeah.
Yeah.
By the way, were they singing along?
Oh, I'm sure they were.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this is something that was always amazing about Sublime and Sublime with Rome, is the way that like it kind of the music for me gives license to macho-ness to be emotional. Does that make sense? Like there's something really touching about the way the songs are really hard and really emotionally open and vulnerable at the same time. It's like, it's a really rare thing
to
pull that off.
No, I feel you. I hear you on that too.
I picture someone crying in the back of the biker rally.
Just breaking down.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Question.
It's okay to cry.
It is all right to cry. Crying gets to
say. All right.
Yeah.
Is Reggae Rise Up still happening in March? Is a question.
Well, the latest I heard, yes.
We hope so. We're really hoping so.
Yeah.
It's on the schedule.
Yeah.
Or so actually, I don't know if we're doing. Are we doing that one?
Florida.
Isn't that April? I thought.
Well, there's one in April in Vegas, and then there's one in Florida in March.
Okay. And, I guess I've been on quarantine for too long. I got to check my schedule again just to make sure.
I just, it's there, and I don't get my hopes up too much, but lately everything's just being pushed back another year, and they're gonna do it when it's safe, and
they're gonna wait until you can play guitar like Yngwie Malmsteen, and then you'll get back in the
scalloped fretboard and everything. Our next tour is actually with the Dirty Heads. I think our next like big tour once everything gets back together.
You on the screen. Do you guys both skate? I know Matt skates. Carlos, are you a skater?
I skate to get down the road. I'm afraid to hurt myself, break my arm or something.
I've transitioned my skating kind of more into that now, to where it's just kind of like, all right, take it easy. Don't want to.
So Matt, were you actually doing intense skating before?
I'd say early on in the Dirty Heads career, I was doing more skating. Growing up, I had like a half pipe in my backyard, and I had all the kids, all the neighborhood kids over, and we would skate like every day. That's what I wanted to do. And then I broke my arm, and then I was like, okay, well, let me put that on the back burner for a while, and then when this heals up, let's do drums. So, but I still jump on the skateboard.
I broke my arm shooting Adventures of Power.
You did?
Yeah, which was, when you're making an air drumming movie and you have a broken arm, it was heartbreaking. It was I had been working on one section of booking this factory, or actually a shipping area in New Jersey. And I've been working for weeks because we shot it in parts because we raised the money in parts and very unconventionally filmed movie. And I had it finally booked, and I had a crew ready to shoot this set of scenes. And I was so happy that we went for the location scout the night before. And I'm like, maybe I'll add a scene where like I'm running up and then I ran across towards where the ship was. And there was like a post where they put the ropes and to tie the ship down. And I ran into it deliberately to make the crew laugh.
Yeah.
And broke my arm.
Oh, shit.
And, and I'm in the hospital, and they're like, yeah, you're not going to be able to move your arm for 6 weeks. And I'm like, no, screaming in the room, like no, you don't understand.
I'm an air drummer.
I have this scene. We're supposed to start shooting in the morning. And they were like, you can't. And so we disbanded it, and we had to postpone like a bunch of the scenes for another 2 months. But some of the crew was like, look, I got another job. But is there anything you can do so we can get some of the stuff shot? So I picked out a few scenes that I could still do with a broken arm. And so if you look in the movie, there are some scenes where if you look carefully, I've got a big cast on.
Oh, really?
I'm like faking it. And, like trying to not move my arm. I was in tons of painkillers and just like trying to get through the scenes, but
that's a bummer.
Yeah. Broken arm's a big deal. I can imagine. So you break your arm skating.
Yeah.
You weren't even a drummer at all at that point, or you had played jazz in high school?
No. Yeah. So it was in high school, and I was part of the drum corps and the marching band and all that. So I had to just sit it out the entire season, and had the cast on, and it was no fun. And
you get sympathy from the girls?
What's that?
You get sympathy from the girls?
Oh, a little bit. Yeah.
Because that's,
I was in a band. There were no girls.
Okay.
So I had this cast from here, and the way that they had to set my arm was like this. So I had a cast like this, and I would take the drumstick, not the glow in the dark drumstick. It was a different drumstick, but I would stick it in the cast like this. Uh-huh. And so I would go home and I'd practice.
Just.
And I did that
like almost traditional.
Yeah.
For 3 months. Exactly. I did that for 3 months. Yeah. Exactly.
So you became Buddy Rich when you did that.
Pretty much. If Buddy Rich had a cast on. Yeah.
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 By the way, Carlos, do you prefer to be called Silos?
Sure. Whatever. Carlos or Silos, right, whatever.
What do people call you in general? I see that.
I mean, if you don't know me, probably Carlos, but if you're my friend, then Silos. So maybe Silos. We're friends.
Okay, so I'll call you Silos. So you have an interesting thing with your drums, your tuning. You want to talk a little bit about, you know, actually Hoffer Teacher would be an interesting example of that, where toms and bass are tuned so that they start becoming indistinguishable. Do you want to talk about how you got into that?
Yeah, I've always enjoyed the sound of real low drums, because it just, I don't know, it just, the frequency hits good for me. And I feel like you can do a lot of fills, since I'm not a double bass drum player. Mm-hmm. I like to incorporate the toms with the kick drum to, kind of make your mind wonder if it's double bass or not.
Right. Low tom is the lowest position in Adventures of Power, the movie. Like my character is demoted. He's demoted. There's a scene where he's demoted to low tom. But it's nice that you're, I'm not sure if it's a compliment to low tom that you're making it sound like a bass drum, or if it's like basically a closeted low tom.
Well, it still has tonality to it. You know, it still has a tone and you know, it's not just a completely dead kick drum with a pillow in it. You know, it's definitely got tone, and it fits. I mean, it fits for what I do, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Have you ever tried two bass drums?
Early in my drumming, I played double kick a little bit, and it was when I was playing. What's that?
Okay. In like more punk and stuff, or what?
Yeah, was it in punk rock stuff, and we were playing really fast stuff, and it was really early in my drumming career, and I remember playing with a bunch of older bands, and I was playing a punk rock beat, but cheating playing it with a double kick, and one of the older drummers came and hit me up, and he's like, it's cool to play double kick, but he's like, if you're gonna cheat and do that kind of thing, it's like, makes you look like a bad drummer. And so after that, I got rid of my double bass and concentrated really on getting my single pedal to sound like double pedal, you know,
32nd notes on
the, yeah, some Lamb of God kind of stuff. Yeah. You know.
Yeah.
Hey, did you have one of those freaking Frankenstein drum kits when you were younger? Like when I was younger, I had like my drum kit, and then like somehow I came up on like this other like floor tom from some other drum kit. But then I had two floor toms because I had those, and then, you know,
exactly.
I like 10 different cymbals, and you just kind of like piece it together and get the biggest drum kit that you can find. I mean,
I had an Olympic Premier drum set. That was my very first kit. It was like a off brand of a Premier, you know.
Yeah.
Or it's like their lowest model, you know. It's like the export series or whatever. But I had that, and I ended up getting a DW tom, and I put it as my rack tom. So it kind of looked like I had a DW kit.
You're like, yeah, that DW tom's going on there for sure.
Yeah. and then I eventually got a different kit, and it had lugs on it that I didn't really like, and I was a big fan of Orange County drums when I was growing up, and so I got all Orange County drum lugs and put them on my drums to make it look like a different kit. But eventually along the road I ran into these guys, and now I can actually have a custom kit without pretending it's a Frankenstein custom kit.
My air drum kit is DW in Adventures of Power. You actually see there's a shot where you see the stool, and it's got the DW is on it.
Yes.
Nice. Yeah, that's Maddie's DW.
Yeah, I play DWs, yeah.
Yeah. you deal with
Donovan. I'm Vessel Drumco.
Nice.
No, it's nice to that the smaller shops are still rocking.
Yeah,
tough with these to keep a small business going. So, 100%. And Don has become like the biggest fish around in drum history. Lombardi, I mean. Question for, well, actually, one thing I just want to plug. We do the everyone who watches Adventures of Power on Amazon, even if you're streaming for free, the money goes to support Music Cares. Music Cares is an organization that run by the Grammy Association that supports musicians in need and in this very, very difficult time for everyone, but particularly for musicians. It's so helpful. And there are some musicians who are not able to tour, not able to do anything, and don't have the prospects in front of them. And so anyone who wants to contribute directly to Music Cares, they can go to adventuresofpower.com. We have a link to donate for us, or whenever you watch the movie, or if you buy it on Vimeo, you're supporting Music Cares. So please
support.
Yes, boom. Please do that. That's and so awesome of you too.
I also want to give a shout out to Modern Drummer that has been so helpful with this whole process and is a really fun partner on this. And for anyone who's interested in drumming, the Neil Peart festival special, which is still is available at the shop at moderndrummer.com. It's 4 hours of interviews and music and people talking about Neil Peart, and it's a beautiful thing. I'm in it for 5 minutes talking about air drumming, but more importantly, like actual drummers rocking and talking about what an influence Neil Peart was. So please check that out and eat your Archies while you're doing it. Those are the important things I have to share, because they're our partners and wonderful people all around. So
yeah, Modern Drummer, man. I grew up reading Modern Drummer for sure. That was like
me too.
The one you want to be on the cover of.
Yeah.
Have you made it to the cover yet?
No.
All right. Well,
I've been in it. I've done it. I've been in it with an article.
Okay.
I was actually trying to look for it the other day, and I had a box of Dirty Head stuff I was just going through, you know, and I was looking for it. I found a couple other things that we did that I definitely kept and I wanted to keep, but the Modern Drummer magazine was one too. And I was looking through it and I found a Modern Drummer magazine. I was like, this must be it. And I went through every single page like 4 times. I went through the whole thing, and all I could find was a long article about Josh Fries. So why did I keep this magazine? It must have been because of Josh. I don't know why I did that. Yeah,
you guys both are in the Josh Fries lineage. So
yeah.
Kind of makes sense, right?
Yeah. I guess like maybe at the time I held on to it because I wanted to show him. Like, I don't know why I had it, or I don't know.
Oh, so you were already friends with him at that point?
I must have. I think so. I mean, I'm friends with him now, so I don't know if I was when I saved that. If I wasn't, maybe I was trying to have something come into fruition or something. I was like, if I hold on to this, we'll be friends one day.
Yeah.
So, but I can't find the article that I was on. So
just keep on looking, because I had one of those too. And I looked through it, I think once, and I didn't find it, but I kept the magazine.
Yeah.
And then I looked through it again.
And then it was there.
It was my first one. And it was like, it was an article about, it was real small.
Oh, yeah, that's what it is.
But I kept it, you know?
Yeah. I'll have to look again. I'll check out.
Yeah, just look at the small ones.
Print magazine, a paper magazine on print. There's something
super
exciting about that. I remember the first time I was in a magazine, I just couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
That glossy paper, and you're like, that's me.
I'm going to hold on to this forever.
I'm part of history.
Yeah. It's there. It's never changing.
So what's next for each of you? What do you want to plug here? Now you have a captive audience. What do you have coming that you can surprise people with that they don't know about?
Dirty Heads, we've released a couple singles during quarantine, trying to put out new music. We've recorded some stuff. We're basically just waiting to see what happens and waiting till we can come play music again for everyone. So I think Carlos will be joining us in the summertime, hopefully things go right.
In what form, in terms of both of your bands touring together, or
Yeah, I mean, we've toured together in the past, and I think the plan is to do it this summer. So,
why don't you guys drag both of your kits on stage at some point and do like a, and like show us where it's at and do a duo?
Yeah,
like you should. Like drum duos, there's a really weird magic that can happen. I'll bet if you like arrange that, I'm sure it would be a pain to do it, but like do it at some rehearsal if you're touring together where you actually just create something, and the energy of two drummers playing at the same time is really crazy.
So well, or maybe we could have one air drummer, like
one of us
like you, maybe Maddie can come air drum a song for me, or I can come
we know someone I think a
professional air drummer. Just saying that there's only one you know who's in the Guinness book. It's this guy.
All right, you got the job.
So I forgot I have to keep both of my computers open for this technical. So confusing.
You're doing a lot over there.
Huh?
You're doing a lot over there. I'm impressed.
It's all right. I think I just mess it up. I think we're good. No, it's still live. Okay. so we are going to move to the watch party, which is at adventuresofpower.com/twitch, which will take you to the Twitch channel. Those of you who don't have a Twitch account, you'll have to make one, which is sorry. And you also need to have an Amazon account because Amazon owns Twitch and the movie streams through Amazon. If you can't watch the movie with us now, please watch it anytime on Amazon. It's called Adventures of Power, or you can go to airdrummer.com if you forget that. You know, during the watch now, you can comment, you can cook your food, and you can make jokes at me, and I will respond on Twitch. So we will move over there in a second. Anything else you guys want to say to your lovely fans?
Yeah, I just want to thank you for having us. This is awesome. The movie's hilarious. You guys are going to love it. And thank you for partnering up with Music Cares, and that means a lot. I know a lot of people are struggling during this time, and that's really rad that you're doing it. And the movie's hilarious. I think it's pretty fucking awesome. So.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So I'll see you guys over at Twitch in about.
Let's do it.
About
yeah, please, guys, stick around for this movie, please. If you guys are, you know, not busy doing anything, if not, then make sure you check it out on the next one. If it's all right, I'd like to give a second for all the drummers who are out there, just to give a shout out to Aquarian, Vessel Drum Co., Peisty Cymbals, and Vader Drumsticks, and also Traeger Grills. They've been hooking Dirty Heads and I up. So much love to you guys, and thank you very much for letting us do this.
Thank you. See you guys at AdventuresOfPower.com/Twitch. Yeah.
Boom.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are about to witness the new breed of warrior.
Her legs so white.
Like white tiger.
We felt something today. We need you.
We are air drummers! Every one of us! Now we're-